Okay, so today we'll try to understand the iron losses or constant losses that takes place in a transformer. Now in iron loss, there are two different types of loss takes place in a transformer. One is hysteresis loss, another one is eddy current loss. So hysteresis loss and eddy current loss we will consider. And we will also learn how to separate them. It is very easy to understand the variable loss of a transformer or copper loss of a transformer that takes place due to finite winding resistance. But it is somewhat more intuitive and more means a bit complicated to understand what is transformer iron losses. So, as I have written, there are two different types of loss. One is hysteresis loss and another one is the eddy current loss. Now, hysteresis loss, let us consider that here in this diagram, I will describe and you will try to tally this diagram side by side. That let us consider a cross section of an iron core is capital A, right? And the length of the magnetic circuit, here I have assumed that you have somewhat confidence and knowledge in magnetic circuit. If not, please visit the PDF, please go through the PDF that I have shared. And also cross sectional area is A, obviously this should be in centimeter square or any unit, here it must be in centimeter, and number of turns capital N, right? Now, as the exciting current, here one thing I would like to mention, that in this diagram that I have shown here, it is, where is that pointer? Instead of showing the 8, here I have shown the ampere turn, this is NIN. In some book you will find H. What is H? H is magnetic field intensity, that is ampere turn per meter or centimeter, whatever, right? So here, and instead of flux, you will get here, they will consider flux density or B. Whether flux unit is Weber, unit of flux density is Tesla. Now, as the exciting current varies from plus IN, so exciting current, what is the nature of exciting current? Exciting current is a sinusoidal current. So here it is, we can write it like IM sin omega t. That is our exciting current. It cyclically varies from plus IM to minus IM. Now, before I proceed further, I would like to mention one more thing here, that here while discussing hysteresis loss, I will try to figure out that how hysteresis loss takes place in a transformer and what is its effect, rather than I won't consider, instead of considering how hysteresis or presence of hysteresis modify the transformer, means voltage wave shape or flux wave shape, or how this nonlinearity actually affect our transformer performance, we'll consider that later. At present, our objective is to just to find out some quantitative measure of our hysteresis loss, right? So here I am assuming that current cyclically varies from is exciting current is following this equation Im sin omega t. In some cases we may observe that it is not exactly following the sine wave equation. That we will discuss later, but for the time being let us consider it is Im sin omega t, right? Now with this consideration, your current will obviously vary from minus Im to plus Im. And another thing, accordingly the MMF will also vary from minus NIM to plus NIM, right? Now, therefore, if the flux should also vary if we apply it across a circuit with constant reluctance and constant permeability and therefore constant reluctance, what we could observe? We could observe that flux is varying from now this whole thing will take place in a manner like the variation begins cyclic, but here there is a problem that this phi m, it is taking place in a manner that when the MMF is zero, instead of the magnitude of flux becomes zero, it is showing some finite value. And similarly, when MMF is negative, instead of flux becoming zero, flux is having some finite value. So this is somewhat we must note. Typically what I was trying to mention, this point where your MMF is zero but flux is not zero, and also here in this point where MMFs are not zero but flux is equal to zero. Actually, to be very honest, this power loss, actually this power loss also due to hysteresis takes place only due to this nonlinear nature. We later on study that hysteresis is known as if we have only saturation, then saturation won't cause any kind of power loss, but this hysteresis cause a power loss. If you want more clear elaboration, let me just show you two different images, then you will understand what I am trying to. Now here in this curve, as I was trying to tell you that if we consider here in this curve, can see that just a minute, yeah, fine. So here this is a curve for the same type of curve while we are having in this direction MMF. MMF or magnetizing current, you can also say, because your turns ratio just act as a amplification factor, nothing else. And in this direction we have now, see, if we consider our flux that is applies to follow the sinusoidal pattern. You may ask me why? Because if you recall the original equation, if you are feeding it from a sinusoidal voltage source, then V is equal to
n d phi dt. If you neglect neglecting voltage drop across series branch, so if V is equal to N d phi dt, then if your V follows Vm sin omega t, then your phi by virtue of this equation needs to be a sinusoidal signal that follows . So basically our flux cannot be cannot take any shape when we are feeding the or when we are connecting the transformer with a means standard dot supply or sinusoidal supply. However, in order to maintain that sinusoidal flux, as we can see that our magnetizing cut now it is only we are considering the saturation effect, but no hysteresis. Now here you can see that this saturation curve, due to this saturation curve, if you want to construct a sinusoidal flux, then what type of current do you need? You need this kind of a peaky current to produce this type of sinusoidal flux. If you want to know that how to construct it, then I can show you. I do not know how much you will get it from me, because it is very difficult to draw it in the pen tablet. I am not a professional artist, but your current curve should be like this, and then you can trace it that point to point. It is like a periscope. If you take the value here, this is your current. This is the direction of the current. Here in this direction, and this is the time. Then if your current is taking this shape, then for each and every value of current following that periscope kind of periscopic action, you can construct the flux waveform, right? And as you are obliged to construct a sinusoidal flux, accordingly your current will take a shape like this. So here you may ask me, sir, you used to say our flux is effect, MMF is the cause, then why are you now claiming at this moment that our means flux, we cannot alter the shape of the flux, rather we are free to alter the shape of the current? So let me reiterate the question once again, then you will get it more clearly. In our previous discussion, I used to claim that MMF is the cause, and MMF by reluctance, that is flux, is the effect. Now you may ask me, sir, if flux is effect, then how or why, rather why we are claiming that flux need to follow a definite shape, and accordingly we should shape our MMF? The answer is that indeed we are no way trying to violate this relationship. MMF is cause and flux is effect. We are still means obeying this relationship. However, the effective flux must be must follow a sinusoidal shape because our impressed voltage is sinusoidal in nature, and that impressed voltage is like means if you consider MMF as your father of this flux, impressed voltage is like its grandfather, who is the very cause of all these things that takes place in your system. So here this impressed voltage can govern everything. So impressed voltage and by as the flux is applies to means corroborate or means it's not corroborate actually, it's obliged to obey this relationship, because if we neglect the losses, then we know that it will give us V is equal to minus E and again E is equal to minus N d phi dt. So from that, flux is obliged to maintain this kind of sinusoidal wave shape. Now, yes, in order to maintain a sinusoidal flux, what we can consider if we need this effect. Like if I ask you that there is no way out, you have to score EX. Then if I there is a terrible pressure on you, then if you are a good student, you have that ability. What is this ability in terms of magnetic circuit? I will explain. You start thinking about yourself that how can I score EX in electrical machine or in any subject. So then you may extend your working hour, starting for some extra hours in every days. So those things can be done. Now here one thing that is very surprising, not surprising rather, so you try to extend your means you are trying to study more to comply with the requirements or whatever I just asked you, that you have to do it, you have to score EX in the machine or in any subject. So you are trying to, now you must be physically strong enough to endure that extra study time. And similarly here, this saturation curve, it must not allow this curve must result this flux value. If we have a curve like this, then obviously it cannot give us this phi m. If we are that we know, and in our class discussion also one student asked me that 4.44 phi m, this formula was there, some formula is there. So your f is constant, n is constant. So if you need phi m, and if your core fails to provide you that phi m, then that is very pathetic. So your core must be made up of such magnetic material that it can produce this of flux phi, as well as your whatever is there, the voltage source, you must get this amount of peaky current. You must have a provision of drawing this peaky current from your source, because until unless you can draw it from your source, you can't produce this kind of waveform. Now back to business, what from where all these discussions started. Even if you are having this kind of peaky waveform, you will see your I-phi, that is if I draw the voltage waveform, you will see our voltage waveform will be like exactly leading this current to a form by an angle of 90 degree. So this red line, this indicates V is equal to Vm sin omega t. It leads this I phi by an angle 90 degree. Now see, what we can claim that here this voltage waveform Vm sin omega t, if you take the product, then what you will have here, what is the this angle? This is pi by 2. So here cos, this will become cos pi by 2. So you will get 0. Therefore, even if you consider the effect of saturation, only saturation cannot result in any losses, because even if you consider saturation, what I was trying to tell you, as a memoryless, saturation is a kind of memoryless nonlinearity. So as it is memoryless nonlinearity, it doesn't alter the phase relation of your current, flux, voltage, all these things. It cannot alter that phase relation. And as long as you are able to maintain the 90 degree phase difference between your magnetic flux and your, magnetizing current and voltage, you will always get this, your transformer will operate at zero power consumption when there is no load, or any load is, if you do not connect any load across your secondary, the transformer will draw zero power from your source. Now what will happen when we will consider hysteresis? Okay, we have reached end of this page. Let me insert that image so I can explain you that what is the problem with hysteresis. It is very interesting, but I do not know how much interest, how interesting you, whether you get any interest in this or not, that I do not know. Anyway, okay, so here where we will include that hysteresis loop, what is happening? Again, our flux the system being fed by a sinusoidal voltage, flux is again obliged to maintain that sinusoidal relationship, phi m sin omega t. It cannot alter. However, what we are observing here, that we need a different amount of current. And now see, the magnetizing current, unlike the previous case, it is having, if you draw it properly, you will see that it will have a curve like this. And when your voltage, if you want your voltage, so voltage wave, if you draw that exactly, oh god, voltage wave that exactly lead this flux by an angle of 90 degree, you will get something like Now see, here we are getting that like previous case, now our Vi cos that if we consider it as theta naught is our no load power factor, then it is not is equal to 0. So this hysteresis is like a non-linearity with memory. So whenever we introduce a non-linearity with memory, it start causing a power loss in our system. Now how we can let us proceed to find out again. Let me insert that diagram once again so you can see it. Yeah, this one. Yes.
So here what we can observe that the exciting current varies cyclically from minus Im to plus Im, and accordingly the flux is varying from minus phi m to plus phi m. Now on the ascending side of this curve, here you will get two sides. This one is our ascending side, right? This one is our ascending side of the curve. This is the ascending side from A to B. That your excitation is changing from Ni, if we consider this small portion, then it is, if at this moment it is Ni, where is that? Here, if in this moment it is Ni, here it is Ni, and here it is and what happened? Yes.
It is Ni plus Di, right?
So in the time dt, we are having this thing. Just wait a while. So that in the we are considering that this I to di, sorry, not I to I plus di, this change, incremental change of current takes place in the time interval of dt. So if that is the case, in that time interval, what is the change in our flux? The change in flux is d phi. Now if that is d phi, the EMF induced according to Faraday's second law and Lenz's law is E minus N d phi dt, right? Now this EMF must be balanced by that impressed voltage, because if we want to maintain current equilibrium, then one thing here I would like to mention, that all these what we are describing here, it is totally for steady state condition. Don't get confused that as I have discussed something non-sinusoidal, I am trying to consider that transient or something. No, it is in pure steady state condition. Steady state condition transformer in low load that we are discussing. Now the instantaneous power supplied by the exciting current will therefore be equal to how much? And if you take this minus EI, so if we consider the energy, dW amount of energy is given, then we can write dW dt is equal to, or you can write it directly, dW is equal to power into time, like minus EI dt. Now minus EI will, this will finally lead us to NI d phi, right? So this unit must be in terms of energy unit, it is in joules. Now this is one thing that is very interesting to note, that NI phi DI, it is proportional to the area of this shaded region. This shaded region, it is a thickness, if you consider that thickness is d theta, it is like a rectangle whose one side is Ni and another side is d phi, right? So the, now you can see that the power loss is directly proportional to the area of this rectangle. And one obvious way to minimize this rectangle area is to shrink your size of the hysteresis loop. If you can shrink it, and finally when you can make this one just like a saturation curve like this, then you will get again the same situation that I just discussed in that at the beginning of the video, that you will have zero power loss. However, now we are having a finite area, and this area is proportional. So the energy consumed as the loop is traversed from here, this point A to point B, as the loop is traveled point A to point B, so what is the amount of energy will be here? Amount of energy will have here, just let me clear this, yeah, now it looks very clear. Represented, the total energy will be this OABP, like this section, right? So this OABP will be the total amount of energy, that is that will be like the total energy that will consume when this point will traverse from point A to B. Now after this point, what will happen here? Your I naught reaches its maximum value. Even if we consider a peaky current, even if we consider this peaky current, it is like this portion. After this, it has to follow, or the current has to exhibit a descending nature. So then what will happen? The current will reduce, and the flux will follow this path. However, here this path, when the current here, what is the value of Ni? Ni is equal to 0 at point C. But see, the flux is not 0. However, the induced EMF changes its sign along this path. And here, when returning, the
amount will be, the energy is returned back to the supply of the circuit by an amount proportional to this BPC, right? Like we can show using two different colors. Here this BPC is the amount when energy is means returning, amount of energy returned to the supply, and this one is the amount of energy consumed from the supply, right? Well, so if that is the case, then point to point around the loop, the net energy consumed per loop, we can write it using this formula, like total energy W is equal to from this is plus phi m, and here it will be how much? It will be minus phi m. So minus phi m to plus phi m, and this is n I d phi. Now what is d phi? This d phi, as we know, what we discussed, we told that the total amount of flux deleted, but if you recall, I told you that the area of this cross-sectional area is capital A. Now if A is the cross-sectional area, A is the cross-sectional area, then what we can write, d phi is equal to a db. What is this db? Db is the, b is the flux density perpendicular to that cross-sectional area. Denoted by A. So this ADB is the, and what is NI? As I have mentioned, the total length is L. If you can recall, we define magnetic field intensity like Ni is equal to HL. So this whole thing can be converted like this equation. This one can be written as here it is minus Bm and it is plus Bm. Instead of Ni, we can replace it like HdB. Clear? So we can write it like it is this W is equal to AL, integration running from minus Bm to plus Bm, HdB. All are in joules, right? So it is also interesting to note that this total hysteresis loss, let me write it once again clearly, otherwise you will have some problem. W is equal to plus Bm minus Bm to plus Bm, here it is Al. Now what is this Al? What is the unit of Al? The unit of Al is volume, because A is area and L is length. So if Al is the unit of volume, it indicates that your loss, your hysteresis loss, is actually proportional to the volume of the core. So if you can reduce the volume of the core, automatically your hysteresis loss will be getting reduced. But one interesting thing to note, that the integral appearing in this equation, again I'm having trouble with my pointer, yeah, in this this equation, this integration, all this integration, they are it's very complicated and cannot be evaluated by any known mathematical method, because the functional relation between B and H, they are varying. They are, means you are, this integration H and B, they are, means relation is varying. So what we can do, we can, and also that relation is not known to us. So we need separate experiment to find out relation between H and B. So, but there are few experimental, few scientists, few renowned scientists who conduct, who conducted several experiments and gave us some empirical formula to find out this hysteresis loss. The pioneering work was done by Charles P. Stamens, that the area, so what we already studied, that hysteresis loss is proportional to the area of the hysteresis loop, and he first proposed an empirical formula where he showed that the area of the hysteresis loop, don't get confused that area of the hysteresis loop is A, no, A is the area of the transformer core. So this hysteresis loop area, I am talking about this loop, this shaded region, we found it out that it is proportional to Bm x, right? Now x depends on material. So what he found, the value of x for low carbon steel, x for low carbon steel using which he conducted his experiment, value of x for low carbon steel is 1.6, right? And for silicon steel it was found 1.7. generally x varies between 1.6 to 2 in this range. So this term, this, now here if we again revisit this equation, W is equal to Al, where I am talking about the volume all the time, Bm minus Bm each dB, where this Al, it can be replaced by, this one can be replaced by where delta is the mass density of your material, and m is the mass of the core, right? So total empirical formula of hysteresis can be given like hysteresis loss PA is equal to this eta. It is material dependent. We already defined our m and delta. F is the frequency of alternation. Or supply frequency.
So this much is our power loss in watt. So in general, what is the formula for hysteresis loss? That is PH right, and this eta depends on material, and x generally we consider x is equal to 1.6. So fine, you got some idea about hysteresis loss. So what is the way out to reduce hysteresis loss? Is to reduce the, what you can do, you can make the volume of the core very, if you reduce the volume of the core, your hysteresis loss will become zero. And so it happens in air core transformer. There is no hysteresis loss. In air core transformer, your mass of core is zero. So you get no hysteresis loss for air core transformer. But for any other transformer, we get a finite amount of hysteresis loss. So point to remember regarding hysteresis loss is that if it is only saturation, then there will be no loss, because saturation, I do not know where that page, one, everything is dark, completely dark, no idea what happened to this page, but you can go back to the previous part of the video to find it out. It is all there. Now what I was trying to say, that one to remember here, let me write it one by one. One to remember, only saturation let me reframe the sentence being memory non-linearity saturation cannot alter the phase of the magnetizing current. And thus only saturation can't cause any form of power loss. It only alters the shape of the magnetizing current.
then what is the second point? Second point is hysteresis being a non-linearity with memory can alter the phase of the magnetizing current and therefore it produces power loss. Third point is power loss due to hysteresis can be represented by an empirical formula pH is equal to eta m delta m bm x where x is generally 1.6. Eta depends on your material, m is the mass of the core, delta is the mass density of the core, or in other way the total hysteresis loss is directly proportional to the volume of the core. So if you increase the volume of the core, for other thing your core loss due to hysteresis will proportionally increase, will increase in a proportional manner. In addition, hysteresis loss is dependent on frequency. So if we make f is equal to 0, the hysteresis loss will also become 0, and same argument is applicable to bm, that is the flux density. If you reduce the flux density to 0, there will be no hysteresis loss. However, reducing flux density 0 implies that you are operating with 0 voltage, because in our earlier discussion we know that flux is obliged to follow a sinusoidal pattern when we are feeding our transformer with constant voltage, sinusoidal voltage source. Flux is obliged to follow a definite pattern. So if you want to make BM is equal to 0, that means you are not feeding your transformer, or your transformer is not connected or not energized at all. And if you want to make F is equal to 0, that means the transformer is operating with steady DC supply, that is why F is equal to 0. And do remember that this hysteresis loss, whatever discussion we have done here, it is only for steady state condition, it is not for transient. For transient analysis I will upload a separate video where we will discuss and deal with all the issues related to transient, right? In the next video, we will discuss on eddy current losses.